Hey everyone, how's it going? Today we're doing Scream Aim Fire by Bullet for My Valentine. I've already put the cover out for that one, so if you want to go and check that out first, just to see how it's performed up to speed and everything, I'll leave a link in the description or over the top here. Over the top. See what I did there? Oh dear. Right, okay. Scream Aim Fire. So it was the first track, I believe, that was written for the 2008 album Scream Aim Fire, or one of the first tracks that were written. I listened to an interview way long ago, just before that album dropped, and Matt sort of said that once they wrote that song for the album, the rest of the album sort of like wrote itself from there. It was quite obvious that they were going a bit more of like a thrashier direction. A lot, especially with this track, a lot of like their Metallica influences and like Pantera and that sort of thing started to show its head a little bit more. This is also, I believe, the first song that was released since The Poison that's in D standard tuning. And because The Poison was all in drop C, right? D standard, it just allows for like a really, again, a really sort of like thrashy, tight, aggressive sound, which I really think they captured on this record. Matt's picking is absolutely unreal through this one. Just to cut you in as well, Padge as well stepped his game up for this record during the recording of it. They went over to the States, I believe, and while they were tracking rhythms and drums and stuff like that, Padge literally locked himself in a room for a couple of months and practiced all his scales and his sweep arpeggios and all that sort of stuff. So you can see him starting to like broaden out his abilities on this album. I believe when the A&R guys came in, or whoever it was, and listened to like the first demo of this song from the label, they said they described it as a heavy metal call to arms, which I think is quite fitting as well. One more thing that I just want to, on a level of encouragement for you guys, because this can be quite a tricky song in places. Around this time last year, I started taking guitar a lot more seriously again and playing music. Now, what came with that was me sitting down and actually, after like flailing around and playing with my reverb and all that sort of stuff, and playing riffs, it was a matter of like sitting down and seeing where I was actually up at in terms of capabilities. And songs like this were just literally not doable for me. I knew the song, I knew how it went, I knew the parts, but as far as like the tight rhythm playing in the right hand, especially in the right hand, this was just non-negotiable. And you'll see, probably since I started my covers, you'll see sort of the step up maybe in ability. Maybe I've gone for more intense songs a little bit recently. And that's just natural, that comes over time. I've still got ways to go, I might add. But if you're struggling with this song to start with, and if you're struggling with it now and you've been trying for ages, it's taken me just less than a year to be able to get this. So, not to say it's going to take everybody else a year, but be patient with yourself. I literally sat down every day with the metronome, really slow, honest, starting at 80 BPM, doing exercises. There's loads on YouTube, that sort of thing, to get you down picking. And primarily for me, it was my alternate picking that's always been the problem. So it was all about slowing the track down as well, using a program to slow the track down. I still do it now with every track that I learn, pretty much. If it's fast and intense, I'll always slow the track down to try and get every note in there and find where everything sits, and just get my right hand used to where it needs to be for that particular song. And this song is one of those. So yeah, so I literally just spent each day just sitting with the metronome, and slowing the track down and playing it slowly, getting it up to 80% speed, 90% speed. And then it got to the point where I thought, right, I'm just going to go for this. And that was this week. So I'd like to think that maybe just less than a year's worth of work on this and other gallopy rhythms and stuff, I might add as well, has really paid off. So for you guys out there who are wanting to get a little bit faster with your picking, just slow it right down. Yeah, and it will take time. And like I said, for me to have released the cover, that I put out, that is a huge milestone for me and a massive achievement, because playing like that does not come natural to me. So, okay, so that's my little story right there for y'all. If anybody's wondering what gear I'm using, by the way, before I go any further, I'm using my BC Rich Matt Tuck signature guitar. That's going straight into Bias FX. That's going straight into Cubase. And I'm using an Everlast 0.88 Ernie Ball pick, which is new for me, and I like it. I was using 0.73s up until recently, a mixture of that and the Black Fang picks, James Hetfield, and I found the rounded edge of these is a lot more forgiving, but I need a little more attack and bite than the 0.73, so I thought I'd give these Everlasts a go and see if they do last for ages, so I'll let you know about that one. Okay, so the first thing about this song is, like I mentioned earlier, it's a D standard tuning. So you've got D, D, C, F, A, D. Okay, so D standard, right? So it's a whole step down from standard tuning. Okay, so you've got D, G, C, F, A, D. And that's your tuning, okay? And there's quite a few songs on this album that use the D standard tuning. So for the intro now, this is a strange riff. I've watched all live performances. I saw him doing it at Slam Dunk. Was it last year? No, year before? God, I think it was the year before. So I actually had the chance, sort of like front row, to see what Matt was doing. We know he's got unusual picking, and you kind of almost have to, I don't want to say emulate it, but you kind of have to like channel it in a way when you're playing this one. But you won't see me like trying to angle the pick backwards like he does or anything like that. But for certain parts, I keep the pick super flat. And then for the gallops, sometimes I find myself coming just a little bit forward, which is just out of habit. So this riff, okay, it's a bit of an odd one. You've got two guitars, as always. You've got one on the left and one on the right, standard heavy metal track, okay? So in your earphones, you've got one sat in your right ear, one sat in your left ear. So it's the guitar on the right that you're most accustomed with, probably, to hearing. That's the one that's going to do the lower riff, the... Okay, but there's a guitar on the left which plays a counterpoint to that. And this is the scary thing. It's got some string skip in it, and that's the part that Matt plays live. So he's doing string skipping, and he's singing over it. I have no idea how he does that. Anyway, okay, so... the first riff. So that's it slow. So that's your guitar that's on the right, okay? And that's gonna happen two times, okay? Now, if you learn this and get it right this time, this is all of your choruses sorted as well. Okay, so how it starts is like this. You've got 10th fret with your middle finger, and then you're going to be going back to 9 with your first finger, and your pinky's going to take care of 12. And it's going to start like this. Okay, that's all down picked. Okay. Okay, all down picked. Okay, then the gallops come in, okay? Okay, so it's this. It's that motion that's going to get you through this song. Down, up, down, down, up, down, down, up, down. Okay, so. I'm just doing 9, 10, 12. And then going back down to your 10 and 9. Okay, then. Once you've landed on that 10 right there, you're going to go back to 9. Okay, so far. Okay, so it really, really is a mishmash of down picking and galloping. It's a bit confusing at first, but if you watch Matt doing it, and if you watch me doing it now, I guess you will get the feel for it. So everything that's... everything that's notey is going to be downpicked. Okay? It's just these you've got to watch out for. The gallops in the middle. So the riff's low. Okay, and what's happening there is he's going to do a pull from 12. So pick 12. Pull off to the open on the fifth string. And then land yourself right there on a 10th fret fifth string. Okay, and give it a bit of a shake if you like. So you've got... okay, that's the riff. And really just pay attention to those gallops when they come in. They're sort of like jammed in there, I want to say. But make sure on the first run of it, the first couple of opens you do are two definite down picks. They're what's going to set you up for the rest of the riff. Okay. So watch where I'm down picking and watch where I'm alternate picking. I'm not speeding through this. I'm using repetition for emphasis, okay? So that you can get it. Okay. Okay. Then what you've got is this thrashy power chord thing that goes down into like a flat five sort of thing. Right, this was the big problem spot for me. Getting all that up to speed was one thing. This is just, how you need to view it is an extension of Matt's flicky wrist style. Just watch him and also listen to the isolated guitar track. I listen to the isolated guitar tracks if I can to do all my covers and lessons to really find out what's going on, right? And this right here, it sounds like his hand is gonna literally fly off with the speed that he's going at. If you watch him live doing it, because he's got, so I think they call it hypermobility, where your joints can go really far back, right? Some of you might have that. Mine stops right there. But you know, you've got people on the thumb can bend all the way back, right? Matt's got that, right? So when he's pinching the pick, his thumb is going really far back and the angle of his wrist is making that pick angle backwards. It's not like he's making a point to angle backwards. It's just the way it sits, right? And because of that, I don't know what it is. He's just got this really fast, flicky action that's going on, but tight as well. Like I said, this sounds like it's going off the rails. So what is it? It's the rhythm that I struggled with, and I'm going to show you the rhythm. I'm going to break it down. It's an 8th fret power chord, if you like. Okay, so 6th string, 5th string. Okay. And you've got this. Okay, that's what we're going to tackle. Watch for the accents, okay? And I'm going to show you the trick that I used because it was unintelligible. It was unintelligible to me to begin with, right? That's the rhythm of it, technically, the accents. Because in the middle of the palm muting, you are going to be accenting. So you're going to be taking your palm off the bridge to accent notes. If you don't know what that means, accenting would be this. So if we were palm muting something, making something pop out, okay? It's the accents that you're going to want to watch out for on this one. So, it starts with just a strum of the power chord, and then you're going to go into something like this. Okay, that's it, slow. I'll do it even slower for you. Just after you've done the power chord as well, just the only thing you've got to worry about is just go down, very typical bullet. Take your middle finger, that's what I like to use, and go on the 9th fret of the 5th string. So you're going to flatten this 5th chord, okay? So you've got 5th chord, so root and 5th, back one fret, you'll flatten the 5th note, okay? Scale. Makes that diminished E flat 5 sound. Okay, so you've got... That's the rhythm of the accents. Okay, then what you're looking for is this. Okay, now all those accents are with a downstroke. If you find yourself getting to one of those accents and you've done an upstroke, you've gone wrong somewhere. Okay, so make sure that you're keeping your alternate picking like clockwork, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Okay. The most beneficial thing I found as well is keep your wrist really loose, okay? Don't go tensing up like I do, right? Or did for many years. It's a temptation. When you play fast, sometimes there is a temptation to really tighten up, but it's just like those sprinters at the Olympics. They look like they're all tightened up and everything, but if you watch it back, it was James Hetfield in an interview that said about this, when you watch it back, everybody's really, really loose in slow motion. It's the same thing with picking. It's exactly what he said. He looks like he's tight as anything when he's playing, but it's actually really, really loose. And this is no exception. So keep your wrist loose and let all of the flicking and the wrist action come from your wrist. Don't get your forearm involved. Trust me on this one. Okay. Okay, and eventually you're going to get that up to speed. Okay, but slow, it's this. Okay. Okay, and just to, if you were to take those out, those accents. Okay. After you've got that down, we're going to go G5. Even though it's not a G anymore because we're in D standard, but. So you've got a 3rd fret power chord and 6th string. Okay. And then here's the key to this album, actually, and this song. Great big stacked power chords with the 5th stacked on top, okay? So you're going to go to a D5 power chord, right? Technically speaking, position-wise. So you've got 5 and 7, right? On the 5th string, 5 and 4. But what you're going to do is you're going to lie your first finger across onto 6th string, 5th fret. And it gives you that almost 7th string kind of sound, I want to say. So G as is. And make that one sound absolutely huge by barring your first finger across. It's used a lot in this song and across this whole album, actually. That's how they get that. That's how they retain the heaviness, I think, as well. And that's, again, thrashy. It just sounds really thrashy. Okay, so that's your riff. That's your guitar on the right. I'm going to play it through for you now, slow. We'll be right back. then at the end of that, just hang on your big low. I want to say E5, but it'd be a D5 now chord, right? Okay. So that's your guitar that's on the right. That happens twice through. So okay, guitar on the left is going to do some string skipping, okay? What I want you to do is go onto the 9th fret. You've got 9 and 7 here, right? Okay, so that's your higher counterpoint for this one. What you've got is you're basically playing the same, I want to say like sort of like, pattern rhythmically, even though the notes are different and the position is different. Okay, so all you've got to worry about is skipping that string in the middle, the 5th string, because this is on the 4th string, but you'll keep on pedaling. The rhythm is exactly the same, keeping on pedaling off of that open 6th string, okay? So you've got 9 and 7. Gallops, making sure to go up to 10. Okay. I just alternate picked that out of habit, but that is all down picked. And this time, your little hammer on and pull off thing is going to be from 10 to 9. And you'll find that is the counterpoint. It's the lower one that we did with the lower guitar. So that's got that classic cliche bullet sound going on there, okay? Okay. Pick it exactly as I am picking it as well. Trust me, that will be the picking that you're using or that you will use when you get it up to speed. Like I said, this is quite unconventional, but just view it as it's an extension of Matt's writing. It's just how he writes. It's how he plays. Yeah, he just really mixes it up. He's really tight with the down picking and the alternate picking. So yeah, it's nice and slow now. After that, what you've got is exactly the same thing on the power chord. Okay, so that runs through twice alongside the guitar that's on the right and then finishes off with your big low E5 power chord, D5 now, okay? So okay, at the end of when both of those guitars hang on that low chord, down the bottom, you're gonna do a pick slide. Okay, how do we do that? We've talked about this before, just grab the edge of your pick. Make sure you're preferably on a string with windings. I like to sort of start from the top here, because if you've got the windings, it's really getting the pick is really gonna like grate against the strings. That really scratchy sort of sound, okay? And just run your pick down. Now, if you're wondering how that sounds so shiny and shimmery on records, in order to get that really big sound. Often what they'll do is they'll dab it in and they'll use like a coin or something that's metal. If you go scraping something that's metal down there, it sounds absolutely massive. It really screeches. If you double track that and sit that either side, it sounds absolutely massive. So if you're wondering why your pick slides might not sound as shiny, I want to say, that's the word that comes to mind, or pristine, or, you know, huge, it's often because if they do a pick slide on the record, it's usually done with something that's metal. So yeah, so that's the end of those two riffs. Okay, in between, what happens? This only happens once. Now live, I'm pretty sure the Padge does this in the choruses just to keep the theme going. Plus, if I were him, I wouldn't want to be playing that. Because it's horrible. A year, yeah, just shy of a year. Just bear that in mind. It's taken me just shy of a year to get that. That's been the main culprit of hanging me or holding me back on this one. So be patient with yourself. Over the top of that part, what happens is these leads. Okay, now you've got two of them doing it. It is a counterpoint part, okay? So you've got one that's on the left and one that's on the right. The right one is going to do the higher notes, okay? And this is the only time this happens in the song. It happens twice in the intro over there. Over that part, okay? So you've got... Okay, keep it all alternate picked. That's literally like clockwork, okay? It's tram picking, if you like. Again, really thrashy. So this, just to reiterate, this is the guitar that's on the left, right? On the left, right? That is placed on the left, okay? So you've got 5, 7, 8. Then he goes up to 10. Then he goes back to 5. And then down to 3. And then he ends it on 5 and sort of slides it out a little bit. Okay? So all together, it's not tricky. And again. Okay, use your wrist, start with the down pick, make sure you use alternate picking from there, and you can't go wrong, okay? Okay, 5, 7, 8, 10. 5, 7, 8, 3. Finish on 5. Okay, and that happens twice. Okay. Okay, so at the same time as that, you've got a guitar that's slightly on the right now that's going to play the counterpoint to that, okay? So it's going to play the higher one. It's going to go... Okay, so slow, that's 8, 10, 12, up to 13. And then down to 7. And then finishing on 8. Okay, so you've got 8, 10, 12, 13. 8, 10, 12, 7. Finish on 8. Okay? Okay? So that's your intro. And those two riffs right there, the main ones, they are played exactly like that for your choruses. Just the only thing to bear in mind, and that's twice through for each chorus, but the only thing there to bear in mind is there's no lead parts over that. It's literally just going to be the singing, okay? Okay, so now we're going to move on to the verse, right? And I discovered something, as I usually do, or always do when I'm doing these songs. There's one shakeup on the verse leading in that you're going to want to watch out for. And it caught me by surprise because I've been playing it for so long with straight gallops. But he actually starts with some down picks. I'll show you. So you've got a guitar left and right. They're going to do exactly the same thing. The only thing that you're going to watch out for is those two pull-off parts that happen in the middle. The guitar on the left is going to take care of the higher ones. The guitar on the right, in true bullet fashion, is going to take care of the lower ones. Okay? So, this is how it goes. It's all gallops. You're going to start with an E5 power chord right here. Okay? So you're going to go... Now, did you notice that it was da dun 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 da da dun dun da? It wasn't da 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 da. If you go listen to the isolated tracks, right, you can hear he doesn't gallop straight away. This is leading in, though. The verse happens two times, okay, this riff, for each verse, and for the solo, in fact. At the start of it, he leads it in with the down picks. When it comes back round for the second time, I couldn't tell you why, but he starts it with gallops, okay? So I'll show you. So this is your left guitar. Okay, so he starts. Okay, it's an odd one, but trust me on this. Okay, so make sure you've got that battery gallop thing down. Okay, so he goes, rings it out, the chord itself, then 1, 2, 3. So he rings the chord out. 1, 2, 3. Okay, with the down picks. Then gallop. Okay, it's a bit of an odd one, and it's a strange one to break down. So I'm just going to keep playing it, and you'll use your ear. As always, it's the best tool that you have. I talk about this in every single lesson. So yeah, I'll play it slow for you. Okay. Make sure you put one mute in before we go over to this pull-off. Okay? The pull-off that's happening is literally going to be... You see Matt doing it live with his pinky? But you can use your third finger and second finger. You can use your pinky and your third finger. I come over with my first finger just out of habit. I guess that's how I've always played it. So that pull-off is going to be third string, 5, pull open, hammer 4. Actually, it's not a hammer on, pick 4. Five, pull open, pick 4. Okay? So you've got... After you've got that, we're going to go to a G5 power chord, 3rd and 5th. And all gallops now, okay? Then what he does is he goes and grabs that D5 with the stacking of the extra note there on the 6th string. Sounds absolutely huge. And then he's going to do something even bigger, and he's going to go down to this B5. And he's going to strum that right there. Same shape, just take it down. So you've got 2 and 4, right? And strum across those bottom three strings. So you've got... Sounds absolutely huge. I love it. So, okay, so that's the first part of the verse. Play it slower. Now, when the verse comes back round, you're going to ditch those down picks that he leads in with for some reason, and you're going to go straight into gallops. And there, you know, you can strum it down. I just really liked it. That's the Dave Mustaine coming out of me, right? I really like to drag those strings to make it sort of grind and sound nasty. So that's the second time round. You're just going to go straight in with gallops this time. Okay, the guitar that's on the right is going to do precisely the same thing each time, but you're going to do 7 pull 5 on the fourth string instead for the pulley licky thing, right? And altogether that would make classic Bullet, Iron Maiden, Thin Lizzy thing, right? So the guitar on the right, exactly the same thing, just watch out for that instead. So the guitar on the right is going to be doing this. Second time, straight into the gallops. Okay. And then they both start or stop with an E chord. Okay, so it'll be... And that will take us into the pre-chorus, okay? The over-the-top part. Okay? If you're finding that I might be playing... I'm trying to keep this slow, right? If you're finding that I might be playing a little bit too fast for you, go down below, use the little thing that slows the videos down on the settings on the YouTube player. Slow it down and go back over it and try and play along to it, okay? Use like online programs and stuff like that where you can import your track in and you can just slow it right the way down and try and play along to it. But just... do exactly what I'm doing with my right hand for this, and you'll have it up to speed in no time at all. No time at all being less than a year for me. Okay, so one more time. Okay, so there's your verse guitars. Now, before we move on, I just want to make a note here that make sure that you're happy with that, just like with the intro riff, which is your chorus, okay, or riffs if you like, because each time we come around to the verse and the under solo, it's going to be played exactly the same way. So now we're going to move on to the pre-chorus. What's going to happen is after the left guitar... goes, that one cuts out and I'll come round to what that one's doing in a little bit now. Your guitar on the right is going to be doing your... Okay, that's your guitar on the right. So what's going to happen is after you've gone... Okay, what's going on there? That's a hammer-on. 5 to 7 on the fifth string. Make sure to put your mutes in between your pedal points. Okay, and you're going back to your... For your sort of stop starts on the bottom there, okay? So you've got... And keep it with a down pick for this one. Then what you've got is this. Okay? That little lick, if we isolate that on its own, it sounds odd because it goes out of key. Got this this sixth fret here that's really nasty. Okay? So you've got 5, hammer to 8. Okay? So you've got a 5, hammer to 8, and then pull to 5, and then pick 6. Okay? There's no 5. I've seen the tabs. It's wrong. Okay? If I may say so. Like I said, listen to the isolated track, slowing it down, you can really hear what's going on. Okay? So it goes... Because I was playing it... I was playing it like that for a while, and when I was doing it, it just sounded... That fifth fret right there just did not sound right. So it's... 5, hammer 8, pull 5, pick 6. Okay? So you've got this. Okay. And it's all down picking. Then you've got 2 opens. G5, D5 with the fifth stacked in the bass there on the sixth string. So. Okay, that's the 4 times that happens on the right. Okay, so it's nice and slow. And then into your chorus. Guitar on the left, once that stops after your it cuts, and then when guitar on the right goes, you're gonna join in with those, okay? You're gonna put those jabs in. So guitar on the left sort of goes like this. Once it goes through twice, the guitar on the left joins, plays in unison exactly the same thing that's on the right. Okay, so all together, guitar on the left. And then you're going to go straight into your chorus, which is exactly the same. There's no leads over the top of it. So if you were happy with the riff that we learned in the beginning that rolls through twice, that's your chorus. It's exactly the same thing. Making sure that once you finish them, so... making sure you put a great big pick slide at the end of that, just like on the intro. And then it goes back around into the next verse, which is verse number two. That's as is. That's played exactly the same way as I've just taught you. Each guitar doing exactly the same thing. Okay? Then you've got the pre-chorus with the hammer-ons. Exactly the same thing again. So that's pre-chorus two. Okay? That goes into chorus two. It's exactly the same thing again. Okay? Which is nice. As difficult and tricky as this song can be, right? Rhythmically. It's a nice standard structure, verse, chorus, verse kind of thing. So yeah, the chorus is exactly the same. Make sure you hang. Yeah, make sure when you're doing your power chords, you're really stacking that note on top on the sixth string. That's how it sounds so heavy, yeah? Make sure you end with a great big pick slide at the end of that. Then what we've got is the best part of the song, which is the Pantera domination type riff, okay? The screaming fire part. So both guitars are going to do exactly the same thing. And yeah, it goes something like this. It's all palm muted, so palm on the bridge. And after you pick slide... That's the first part of it, okay? And that's completely chugged off. Tight. Yeah, we're not letting that ring out, okay? So it's all based off of your low E5 shape power chord right here. And it's all with the down pick, okay? All down picked. Make sure that last one you ring out, okay? Then what you've got is this G5 power chord. Make sure when you're doing that, you're giving it a bit of a bend, okay? Just pulling on the strings ever so gently, not a whole step bend or anything like that. It's just gently. Just pull toward the floor with your wrist, not your fingers, otherwise this is gonna happen, okay? Thumb on the neck. Use your wrist, and it's a gentle movement. So, okay. After that, he really lets those mutes ring out. Okay, and the way I'm doing that, or the way he's doing it, and you're gonna do it, is you're going to bring your palm further back. You're still palm muting it, but you're not killing the strings off. You're letting them really resonate, okay? Let your gain, your guitar, and let all that stuff do the work and let it sustain. Then, big pinch harmonic. I tracked it down to the 3rd fret, 6th string, after sitting for ages going... trying to find out where it sounded best. Those pinch harmonics on that song are so dubbed in. They kill, man. They're just so loud. I think they must have had quite a few guitars like dubbed in doing it. But for my rhythm guitars, left and right on my cover, they just kill mine straight away because they're just so... in your face. But where I track them to, usually sometimes they'll pick 2 frets, so maybe they'll play like a 3 here and a 5 here, okay? Where I've done it for my cover is just your standard 3rd fret 6th string. I know live, like Matt will do like a like you'll pick like a higher note and really bend it and let it come down. But on the track, on the album, it's I think it's 3rd fret 6th string. And how I'm doing that, I've got a video. If you want to learn more about pinch harmonics, I've got a video with, I think it was 5 or 6 tips I had for getting your pinch harmonics to pop out. So be sure to check that out. I'll try and remember to leave a thing across the top here for you. But it's on my channel if you scroll back a bit. So we're going to pinch. We're just going to use the meat of our thumb straight after the plectrum and give the string a good old bit of a wobble, a bit of a vibrato right there. And make sure that, you know, where you're doing it, I go into this more in depth on my lesson video. Pick somewhere that's harmonically rich to pick along here. If you're finding that the pinch harmonic isn't quite popping out, so keep going along the string until you find where the harmonics are really rich, and that's where you're going to pick. Okay? And then it's muscle memory. You just sort of remember where it is. Okay? So the second half of that breakdown, if you like, would be... Last one is a ring out. Then you've got 2 more of these G's with the bend, and then you're gonna go C, B. Okay, so 3rd fret with your notes stacked on top there. Okay, so 3rd fret, 2nd fret. So all together, I'll try and get the harmonic. If it doesn't, then... Yeah. Okay. And that is literally your breakdown. Then it goes into the solo, which we're going to do at the end. We'll stick with the rhythm guitars for now. So for the solo section, the rhythm underneath is exactly the same as the verse sections. Okay? So all the... So that's exactly the same. Then after that, you've got pre-chorus number 3. Which is played through the 4 times, okay, with the left guitar dropping out and coming in, precisely the same as I taught you the first time round. Then we've got the chorus, and believe it or not, it's exactly the same thing again, okay, which happens twice. At the end of that, you're gonna hang. And wait for the shotgun, okay? So you've got... Okay, so wait for the of the shotgun, right? And you're gonna go back into that breakdown that we learned and play it exactly the same way. Just when you go into it, when that shotgun loads itself, right? Make sure you lead in with a, okay? You slide down the strings. Just pick a spot, pick the 6th string, you know, or the 5th string together. Something like from 12th fret and just, and then into the Pantera domination type riff with the pinch harmonic. Then the part you've all been waiting for. Okay, so this. Okay, right, what is that? I spent a good hour, isolated tracks, slowing it down over and over and over again, watching live performances. A lot of them people just seem to cut off for some reason. And sometimes you just can't even see what the hell they're doing. So this is what I've gathered, and I'm 99, maybe 98% certain this is right, okay? And this is really hard to play slow, okay? So I'm going to do my best. Okay? So you're going to start with a... It's all palm muted. So you've got 6 to 5, 3 to 5, okay? Okay, then what you're going to do, you're going to go up to 6, up to 8, odd, back to 5, 6, 3, 2, open. 3, 2 is like, it's like, it's over in a second. Okay, so it's... Okay, and it's actually nice to know that it's not just a load of waffle, I guess. You know, it's not just and then done. There is actually a science to it. There is actually notes in there. If you listen really, really hard and slow it down, you can hear notes. You can hear the fact that it starts from the 6, goes down to the 5. Then you can hear that it definitely comes 3 up to 5. Well, I could anyway. So yeah. Okay, I'm just playing it over and over for you. And that's it. So, yeah, it's over in a flash. Okay, and there's your rhythm sections to Scream Aim Fire. I'm actually semi in disbelief that not only have I... managed to be able to play it to get a cover out. I've actually been able to teach it to you guys. So yeah, a year well spent on my part, I guess. And hopefully that's been helpful. Like I said, from the very beginning, just watch out for the gallops. Down, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, down, up, down. If you're struggling with gallops, go and maybe start, if you're hellbent on learning this song, of course, you know, slow it down, learn your galloping, put the metronome on. But also go and learn some other songs that the gallop's not so intense. Anything off of Kill 'Em All, Metallica. If you go learn the Four Horsemen, that's where I started for gallops and stuff like that. The Four Horsemen is great example. That's a really good one that I'd strongly recommend. I'm sure there's some Maiden tracks out there as well, you know, the Trooper, which are good to get you galloping down with as well. This is one intense track, so if you're struggling with it, okay, go back a generation and find out what inspired Bullet for My Valentine. Go and listen to Iron Maiden, early Metallica, stuff like that. That's where they're getting it from, and they've just vamped it up to a million on this one. Songs like The Four Horsemen are a perfect example. If you want to go slower than that, Children of the Grave, Black Sabbath. something like that. That's perfect. Master of Reality, Black Sabbath, Children of the Grave. You will not regret it. Watch the live version as well. The only thing you've got to worry about there is you're tuning your guitar down to a C-sharp standard tuning. But yeah, again, that's even slower again. So build up to this. That's what I'd strongly recommend. The last point that I'd make is make sure that when you're doing those power chords, you're really barring your finger across onto the sixth string. So you've got normal power chord here. And that's how you get that big sort of thrashy seven string kind of vibe going on. Okay? So, solo time. Let's get to it. So for the guitar solo, it's literally going to be, if you know your modes and your shapes and stuff like that and your scales, it's just all E minor natural position shapes. Okay? With one harmonic minor note on the sweep. Okay? But if you know... if you know your scales, it's natural minor or Aeolian 101. And also it's very sort of like part driven. It's fast and it's kind of over in a flash. It's sections, it's composed. Patchy solos are generally quite composed. It's like technique followed by technique followed by technique, if that makes sense. It's not just like a blur, like a Marty Friedman solo, for instance. Okay, so how's it start? It starts off with this... No, I'm kidding. It does. Okay, it does this unison harmony bend. And the wah pedal is on here. The wah pedal is on for the majority of the song, or the solo, I should say. So you're going to take your pinky, 15th fret, second string. And then you've got your third finger, which is going to take care of 14th fret on the third string. Get your fingers behind that now to help you push that up, because you're going to strum both those strings together, and you're going to push up with your first, second, and third finger. Pinky is going to stay where it is. It's a pedal steel thing, right? Okay, so you've got... once you've done that, come back down. So bend it up. So pick, bend, back down. When you come back down, off to your first finger, which was there anyway on 12th fret, which was helping you push that string up, okay? So think ahead a little bit with this. With this sort of thing, with bending, when you're going to be coming back to notes. If you think ahead and you've got your fingers in place, you can save yourself so much time, and it helps massively with speed. So you're going to pick. And when you get to 12, give it a really good shake. Okay, then you've got this. So what am I doing there? You're just going to pedal off of 12th fret. So put your first finger at 12th fret. Then you're going to have 15. Okay. And watch my picking. Clockwork. Okay. Down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Starting with a down. So you've got 15, 12. 14, 12. You're only there once. And then it's back to your 12. Back to 15. Up to 17 with your pinky. Okay, if you're struggling with that reach, keep your wrist inward. And I don't mean like this. Yeah, I mean inward toward the body of the guitar. If you turn your wrist inward, your reach and your range will become much longer. Okay, and you'll have a tornado of souls down. You know what I'm talking about, in no time at all. So you've got... now, for finger choice, I actually go third finger for 15, second finger for 14. Then I've got my pinky that's available to go up to 17. So I've got 15, 14, back to 15, 17. And that runs through twice, precisely like that. No difference. Just like that, okay? okay? Okay, so far. Really slow once more. Okay, at the end of that, we're going to do a massive bend, 15th fret, okay? Okay, very Zach Wilde-esque, I guess you could say. And very, very Page-esque. He does a lot of this, okay? Where he's bending to on there is kind of... He's kind of like going just over a whole step bend, I want to say. He's really going up there. Best way to get your bend, keep your thumb over the neck, yeah? If you don't put your thumb over the neck, that's going to happen, okay? Your thumb is your anchor point. Get a good grip, thumb over the neck, and you're going to go 15, pick, and then bend. Once you're up there, let it down and do it again. Okay? Okay? Sounds dreadful on its own, I know. Okay? So you've got... And once you're up there... Give it a really good shake with your wrist. That's not my fingers doing that, okay? Vibrato does not come from the fingers, comes from your wrist. Pivot your wrist, yeah? That sort of emotion. Okay, then we've got the sweep. Okay, so... It's not actually that difficult, he says. I don't sweep. It's not a massive part of my playing, believe it or not. It's just never been something I've invested a whole lot of time into. I am 100%, if you ask me, I am 100% more happy spending time on making sure that my rhythm is up to speed than being able to sweep all over the place 100%. Because if you get in a room with a bunch of guys and you want to try out for a band or something like that, the whole song is rhythm. But if you go in there and you sweep up and down with your minor, harmonic minor arpeggios, they're going to, oh, cool, man, do that in the solo. But then for the rhythm part, if you haven't practiced your rhythm, and that's a good 90% of the song, you're going to be in a world of trouble. So I am 100% more happy to have invested my time into making sure I'm tight here. That being said, rhythm is probably more my weakness. Lead guitar... I can pick up a little bit quicker. That's just the way I work. So the solo for me on this one came last because I knew that if I just spent an afternoon doing this, I would get it down and be able to do it. Because by now, I sort of know Page's solos, shall we say. I kind of understand and get what he goes for and his note choices. I understand how it works on a composition level. All that's left for me then when I'm transcribing these things is to make sure that I can actually play it up to speed, and that's just like setting an afternoon or an evening or whatever the time aside to sit down with the metronome and get it up to speed. So this sweeping pattern, how's it go? That's actually a hammer on there. He's starting off with an up pick here on 17, second string, and that leads you in. Okay? Starts with an up, then the sweep starts. Okay? So he's going to go 16 on the third, back to 17 on the second, 15 with your first finger. Okay? And the best thing to do for sweeps is just brush the strings. Isolate that part. Get the, if it's across three strings, which Padge does a lot of, get used to this motion. If you find, if you took the strings off, and you're getting... Yeah, that means you're dragging too much. Okay, so make sure that you're going light. And get that motion going. Okay, and also do the same for your left hand. If you can hammer it. If you know that you can do that, you know your left hand is not the problem here. You know it's your right hand, so it's a matter of getting these two in sync. So making sure you can go. Yeah, then isolate this. Then put it together. Okay, so I'm going 17, 16, then I'm going back down to 17, 15 first. When I go 15, I'm going to hammer 19. There it is. And then pull back to 15. Okay. Then I'm coming back down to 17, where I came from. And then I'm coming back down to 16, where I came from before that. Okay. So I've got... Okay. And I start with an up, up, and then go down when I'm actually going down the arpeggio. So. Okay. So he runs that through twice, I think. Yep. And then he's finishing up there on 17. Then what happens is he's going to do this harmonic minor one. That one there. That's your harmonic minor note right there. Your classical, sad sort of despairing note, if you like. And we're going to go like this. Now it's nice because that only happens through once. Okay. So you're going to go 14. Yeah, then you've got 16 on the second string. Then you've got 14 with your first finger. And your pinky, or your third finger, up to you, is going to take care of 17th fret on the first string, okay? So you've got... Okay, but how it works is this. And then it finishes off on that hammer-on and pull-off. So it's the same hammer-on and pull-off technique that was on this one. Okay. So after you sweep and you've done the pull off, you're going to come over to 17th fret on the second, and you're going to do this. Now you don't see me bend that note on my cover because I didn't, obviously. I got it to sound better actually playing the note that that's bent to. Okay. So, but this is what Padge does. Okay. So he goes 17, second. Then he's going to come 19, 17, 15 on the first. So you've got this. Then down to 14. Okay. So. Yeah, then down to 14. Okay, then you've got this classical run, kind of like reminds me of a Locust Machine Head. Okay, So you're going to go like this. You're going to start again from the 17 on the second string. Then you're going to go 19, 17, 19, 15, 19, 14, 19. So you're pivoting off of that 19 after that. So... After that, I've got 17, 15, back to 17, up to 19, and finish right there on 15th fret, first string, okay? So, now I know Padge goes on his instructional video, but that note there, 14, is exactly the same as 19 here. Just for some reason, the pattern seems to work best for me here. So it's a lot easier for me to do that than come back a fret. So altogether, okay, so after that, we've got this little tapping section. I rest my thumb on the top of the neck. My pick disappears into my first finger there. Okay, always anchor with your thumb on the top of the neck. Don't just... You're going to miss notes if you're just doing that with your arm or your wrist. Have an anchor point. Use your thumb. It's there for you. Put it on the top of the neck, okay? And you're going to put your first finger, 12th fret. Okay, and that's going to hammer onto 15. Where we're tapping from is 19 on the first string, all on the first string, and you're going to go something like this. Okay, now in my cover, I think I did it a bit more erratically, like, but when it's slowed down, you've got this. Okay, so you're going to tap, have your first finger ready on 12, tap 19, pull to 12 and hammer 15. Okay? So you've got. Okay? After you've done that, do 14 instead of 15. Just replace the 15 with 14. Tap in hand stays exactly where it was. So you've got. Okay, that's really easy, basic tapping right there. So the technique is tap, pull, hammer. Okay, dead simple. Okay, up to speed, you've got something like this. Okay, so that's your tapping section. Thumb comes off the neck, pick reveals itself, okay? And you're gonna just do this very basic scale run to finish up. It's all hammer-ons, so you've got... So that is 12, you're just gonna go straight up the natural minor scale and at 12th fret. So you've got 12, 14, 15, pick, hammer, hammer. Okay, then you've got same thing, same pattern again on the fifth string. Okay, which is 12, 14, 15. Then what you're gonna do is you're gonna spread the shape, you're gonna leave a gap between each finger, okay? So you're gonna leave a gap between each fret. You're gonna go 12, 14, 16 now. Okay, same thing on the next string. 12, 14, 16, this is the third string. So far you've got this. make sure that your hand is moving down the strings for those hammer-ons. Make sure that your right hand, that is. Make sure that you're following on. Okay, once you get to the third string, come forward a fret and do the same pattern. You're going to have 13, 15, 17 this time. Okay. After that, come forward a fret again, and you're going to have 14, 15, 17. There it is. Okay, so it's... Okay. So all together... At the end of that, big whole step bend. Get all your fingers behind. Yeah, all your fingers behind 17th fret. Okay, and you're going to pick and bend up, whole step bend. Okay, what that means is we're bending up two frets. You're aiming for that bend to sound like this fret here, whole step bend. Okay, so all together. Then to finish off, you've got this, which is a really nasty sounding unison harmony bend again. What's going to happen? Put your first finger over on 12th fret, first string. Third finger. You can use your pinky for this, but just as a feel thing, I prefer my third finger. Put your second finger behind it to give it some help to bend. First finger's not going to bend. It's going to stay where it is. And you're going to bend the pitch of 15 up to the pitch of this note here, which is 12. So you got to keep your first finger where it is, keep your thumb over the neck, pick both strings and just bend. And use your ear, you'll know if you've gone too far. Too far. Okay? So all together, that's... Okay, so all together, I'll play it through really slow now. If you want to stay up to speed, you got my cover to go check out there, but nice and slow now. Okay, there it is, slow. There's one last thing that I need to show you, which is the counterpoint with the... There's a lower guitar that comes in right there that does this. Okay, so you're going to move the shape back. So you can choose either one that you want to do. I did the higher one in my cover, and then I just stuck this part on later on. So you're going to come back to your minor natural position here over at 12th fret, actually. So what you're going to do is you're going to start with your bar. You're going to go. And you're going to bend, half step bend that. You're going to half step bend. So you only bend into the pitch of 15 here. So pick 14. And you're going to bend. And that will harmonize with the bend that you're doing up here. Okay, so you've got. Then I'm going 12, first string, down to 15, 14, 12, 10. So you've got... Okay. Okay. Then you've got... Which is the similar sort of pattern, but this time you go in 12, 15-14-15, 15-12-15, 15-10-15. Okay. Then, and that's it. You've got 13. So 13, 12, 13, 15 on the second string, and then finish up first string right here on 12. So you've got... So you've got... So all together, that's... Okay, and that's literally it. That is Scream, Aim, and Fire. Like I said, if you haven't got checked the cover out, it's the last video that I did. And yeah, it's a really fun one. Once you can get it up to speed, just be slow with it, be patient with yourself. If you've got any questions, just come find me on Instagram. Drop me a... Oh, there goes the pick. Come find me on Instagram. Drop me a message or leave a message on the comments below. And I think this is the first chat video that I've done since I hit 200 subscribers. So I thought I'd just take the opportunity to thank you all so much for subscribing. We're at 222 now, 222, which is absolutely something I never thought would happen. So thank you so, so much for all your support, for subscribing. Live streams are happening on YouTube now. Generally on a Tuesday night around 8 p.m. UK. It's literally just chilled out sessions where I just play a bit of ambient guitar, some open sea stuff, and we chat and we have a good time, and yeah, it's nice. Link to my lessons is down below also for anybody who wants Zoom one-on-one lessons with me, as well as my Instagram and all that other good stuff. So I hope you've really enjoyed this video. If I've missed anything out, just let me know. I'll try and help. And yeah, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Cheers, guys. Thank you very much.